Synthes. First of all, I would like to apologize because we had a little bit of delay because this was running at the same time as another workshop. She came to Valencia yesterday, invited by the Museum of City of Science, and since she is now quite busy, we have a little bit amused of her and profited for proposing a colloquium on gravitational wave, which is one of the hot topics today. So just a brief summary of her curriculum. She is member of
short.
She is member from the LIGO and the GEO collaboration just from the beginning. She's also collaborating with LISA and is participating in the Einstein Telescope. She is professor at the University of Les Illes Balears and has been Marie Sklodowska-Curie and senior researchers at the Max Planck Institute from Potsdam, and has many collaborations and has taken important responsibilities in all these experimental collaborations. And today, guys, I want to be brief, I give her the word.
So I will start. Thanks a lot for inviting me. Thanks a lot, Professor Bernabeu, for this nice invitation. It's a great pleasure to be here in Valencia. All the FIS colleagues and the non-FIS colleagues and the non-FIS that are also here. So, well, the transparencies are not 100% in English. I'll tell someone in Spanish because I did not finish the translation back into English. I prefer to give talks in English, but the last 2 weeks, now I'm used to, I think the Spanish one is completely memorized. So let's see, because now I put together whatever was in this version, and let's see what comes out. Can I interrupt? So, well, we're going to talk about gravitational waves, the new messengers of the universe. So, what's this about? So let's go back to a century ago, where Albert Einstein presented his, I would say, his masterpiece, a new theory of gravitation called general relativity. And a year later, himself published his first paper on gravitational waves, gravitational sphere. Funny that this theory was also predicting other things of existence of black holes and so on, but Einstein himself did not believe in the existence of black hole in nature. And also when he started doing some calculations, he realized that, well, these gravitational waves are so weak, he believed that they will never be detected. So, but I think he wouldn't mind. So, well, according to this, as you all know, you are a physicist, theory, gravity is not a regular force, but is related to the curvature of the space-time. And just quoting Wheeler, basically, matter somehow tells the space how to curve, and the space tells the matter how to move. Now, the problem starts, or the issue starts, when matter moves. If matter moves, then the curvature of the space-time somehow has to follow the movement of the matter, has to follow it. But space-time cannot react as fast, because information at most can propagate at the speed of light. So there is this kind of perturbation. The matter moves, space-time cannot react that fast, and we have these perturbations, these ripples in the space-time that are the gravitational waves, waves that propagate at the speed of light, carrying information about its origins. So basically, any matter moving or accelerated, not any technical things, produces gravitational waves, but these waves are extremely weak. So basically, only we have a chance to detect something, or the waves that have the strongest intensity, will be those coming from astrophysical, catastrophic, or extreme events that happen in the universe. For example, the merging of black holes, or binary stars that are orbiting close to each other almost at the speed of light, or from supernovae, or basically from the Big Bang itself. And basically, with gravitational wave, in principle, you could even obtain information about what was going on with the universe even when it was younger than a second. Something that's information that you cannot obtain at all, let's say, with your electromagnetic observations. Now, the challenge, current challenge in gravitational wave astronomy is first to detect these gravitational waves, and second to extract the information that they contain. And if we detect these gravitational waves, we can try to explore a number of questions in physics, and some first examples are: how do black holes form? if in general relativity the correct description of gravity, or how does matter behave under extreme conditions. In the history of astronomy, every time there has been opening a new band in the electromagnetic spectrum, there have been major discoveries. And now we are not adding an extra band to it, we are basically providing a complementary and completely different full spectrum with properties different. In particular, we are talking now of vibrations of the space-time, not in the space-time, emitted by the coherent motion of huge masses moving near the speed of light, and not vibrations of the electrons in atoms, and basically cannot be swarmed, scattered, or shielded. So basically this provides a new and a unique way to observe the universe. And therefore, since the information we can obtain will be completely complementary, basically, this could revolutionize the concept that we currently have of the universe. Somehow we are providing a new sense. If with the electromagnetic waves we have a way of seeing the universe, now metaphorically we can say that with gravitational waves now we can listen to the universe. They do interact with matter, but very weakly. They are also transversal waves, they have two polarization, what we call pass and cross, and basically this is the effect that the gravitational wave has when in the direction that travels, basically I can become shortened and a bit fatter, and suddenly I can become stylish as the wave passes by and forth. As in the case of electromagnetic waves that we span 16th order of magnitude, in principle gravitational waves could exist at any frequency. The frequency in which the waves are emitted basically depends on two things, the masses and how compact the objects are. So the most massive the object is, emits at a lower frequency, and the most compact it is, emits at higher frequencies. Basically, most of the common astrophysical sources emit below several kilohertz. We don't believe that there is any source at all emitting higher than 10 to the 11 hertz. And we only have a chance to do what we call direct observations of gravitational waves starting at 10 to the minus 9 hertz. Below that, we can only basically be doing what we call indirect measurements of gravitational waves. And only starting at these frequencies when we could really observe this shrinking or deformation of the space-time. And this is basically the spectrum, the big range, several orders of magnitude. This is what we call the high-frequency regime, going from a few hertz to several kilohertz. And this is what can be seen with the current ground-based detectors like LIGO, Virgo, Tama, and so on. If you are interested in, let's say, more massive objects, you then are interested in going to the low frequency regime, but that is completely inaccessible from ground. We have the oceans, we have the we have humans. So basically the wall below the hertz is basically impossible. So if you are interested at low frequencies, the only way to do measurements is that you go to space. And for that there are several projects or hope that some years from now, we would have ELISA watching the what we call low frequency regime. For the ultra low frequency regime, that you can have pulse atomic arrays, and with indirect measurements, you could try to look at the pinholes in the cosmic microwave background that also were quite famous on that. And of course, then you have different sources in the different frequency bands. If we study gravitational waves, then they will help to answer many questions in fundamental physics, in astrophysics, and in cosmology. And here I have more extended lists of topics like to answer like how abundant then are Skellamas black holes that have become very popular now. What's the mechanism that can generate gamma ray bursts? How do massive black holes form? What role they play when they form galaxies? What happens when a massive star collapses, etc. In fundamental of physics, what are the exact properties of the gravitational waves, if they really travel at the speed of light or not, if general relativity is still valid under strong gravity conditions, if really the black holes in nature are the black holes as predicted by general relativity or not, and in cosmology could provide some information about the accelerating expansion of the universe. But up to some weeks, a month ago, what do the people knew about gravitational waves? What was the experimental evidence that this was not just something from the theory? So as you all know, these two guys, Hulse and Taylor, that they in the 74, they discovered a fresh pulsar in a binary system, and they got the Nobel Prize for that in 93. And I guess they got the Nobel Prize because in some years later, in 82, Taylor and Weisberg did not get the Nobel Prize. And it was not Hulse involved in that. The two of them realized that the orbit of this binary system was shrinking, was losing energy, and they realized that the energy that was lost by the system was exactly what is predicted by gravitational waves, by general relativity in the emission of gravitational waves. And then their observations, they could realize that they were integrating over time, taking the proper measurements, fitting extremely well. So this was like a confirmation that gravitational waves really exist. Although it was not measured as the direct effect of the wave, but that the system was losing energy. Of course, this system will eventually will collapse, but I don't worry too much because this might still take 300 million years until they collapse. So, and they are not in the ground based band, not in the LISA band, they are at very low frequency. Okay, now we are used to observe electromagnetic waves, but up to now we have not seen, till from recent times, any gravitational wave. Why? Well, because this was a technological challenge. Why? Because, as I said, these waves are very weak. Even for a very strong source, being quite close by, like the merging of two neutron stars at a distance quite reasonable, let's say 100 million years from Earth, basically the perturbation that they will produce is, let's say, of one part in 10 to the 22. These are one of the strongest. So that means that if I consider the distance between the Sun and Saturn, and these strong signals come through, this distance is going to shrink and expand, drag this one, the amount equivalent to the atom of hydrogen. And this one to detect on ground with detectors like LIGO. So LIGO has to be able to make measurements with his 4 kilometers arm of able to measure displacements below the size of one over a thousand, the size of a proton. And when advanced LIGO will reach full design sensitivity, it will be able to even detect these perturbations of the 10,000th part of the size of a proton. So I think this is remarkable. Well, this basically can only be achieved currently with putting the sensitivity at the limit with laser interferometry. And the concept is very simple. Is that these have these very long arms, in the case of LIGO 4 kilometers, and if I would have a wave propagating on top of the detector, basically as the wave passes, one arm will shrink and the other one will extend in a different way. And then I would like is to measure the difference in this arm length. So basically, LIGO is a very complicated version of a microlens interferometer in which I was having the laser light, beam splitter, and you have the LIGO in here, then the arc cavities are type Fabry-Perot arc cavities, the light bounces back and forth several times, and eventually gets recombined in, and if nothing happens, it should be destructive interference. But if there is some little change, then you don't have 100% of destructive interference, and you might be recording some light. That's the easy version. Of course, the system is extremely complex. And this is not science fiction, because since between the period of 2000 to 2010, there was already a global network of gravitational wave detectors, what was what we call first generation, that were observing. There were the LIGOs, that were at that time three LIGOs, two in Hanford and one in Livingston. Then there was Virgo, that is 3 kilometers unlength, Cassina next to Pisa. GEO-600, of arm lengths of 600 meters in nearby Hannover and Rutter. There was TAMA. TAMA was just 100 meters in Tokyo. And basically, all the big detectors have been dismantled in 2010 and 2011 in case of Virgo. During these years, the only one that was operating was small GEO-600 and was tuned in case that any supernova nearby would happen to detect it. But last September appeared the first detectors of this future network of advanced detectors with the two LIGO in the States. Next, well, at the end of this year, Virgo will also come in operation. In 2019, but with quite poor sensitivity initially, the Japanese Kagra detector in the Kamioka mine underground and with cryogenics will also come up. And it's also planned that the third LIGO detector, instead of being placed in the States or replacing Hanford, is going to move to India and maybe it could be operating in 2020. LIGO, that means Laser Interferometer Gravitational Wave Observatory, as I said, consists of these two detectors. One in Livingston, Louisiana, surrounded by alligators. One in Hanford, Washington State, the desert, our secrets, etc., etc. And this is all funded by the National Science Foundation and conceived, built, and operated by Caltech and MIT. Plus some money from the Max Planck, from the UK, and from Australia. But usually it's not mentioned, but they also have contributed monetarily. These are some details. This is one of the tubes. Usually you only see the outer. This is the inner. This is very high vacuum inside. The tanks where you have all the suspension systems inside there. One of the mirrors. The quadruple pendulums with all the controls also behind. And then the optical bench. And I'm not an experimentalist. You can ask me something. I might know the answer or not. But the research in LIGO is not done by the LIGO lab, it's done by a body that is a complete separate body from it, called the LIGO Scientific Collaboration, composed of more than 1,000 scientists in more than 90 institutions in 15 different countries, and here you have the map, and this includes Spain. Virgo collaboration, I think, is about 250 people. Initially was France and Italy. And now has been expanded for Poland, and Hungary as well. And here are the logos of the institutions. And in both in LIGO and in the GEO, the German British detector near Hannover, we collaborate, we have MOUs with them, and so far we have been the only group in Spain, and then I hope. That this is basically one of my last talks that I say that there are no further groups involved in ground-based detectors. I hope that in the near future that maybe this gets extended with other groups. And these are the current members in the MOU who were more last year when two PhD students finished and left the group. Two seniors, we are only two seniors, are members of the LIGO Council. I've been involved in it since I've been introduced since 1997 when I started my postdoc at the Max Planck. And basically, we focus on searches for binary black holes, the ones that have become very famous, and also neutron stars, and all the computational model that is needed to identify the sources. These ground-based detectors, what they can see. Basically, we classify what they can see in four categories. The, what we call, compact binary coalescence systems, that either form from black holes or neutron stars, or black hole neutron stars, that they are coalescing. And this is a very short signal. In usually these signals are extremely well modeled, even for the case of black holes, a bit less in the case of neutron stars, and there is a lot of studies here done in Mallorca in the case of binary black holes, and also here in Valencia in the case of neutron stars. Another kind of signals are the bursts that are usually are a model and usually related either to supernovae or cosmic string. And again, in cosmic string, you have a very strong group here in Valencia. Study them, that they also have provided catalogs that have been used in the past. Then another completely type of source is that even this neutron star, that usually they could be in binaries, but also they could be isolated, or even if they are in a binary, because they rotate and these are very peculiar objects, they also emit continuous gravitational waves, but much, much weaker than when this signal of the colossus, several orders of magnitude weaker. But they emit basically continuously, and this is an almost monochromatic signal. If we could detect them, then we could get a lot of information about how matter behaves under extreme conditions of temperature, pressure, magnetic fields, etc. And these are one of the beasts that I spent my last, 19 years searching for them in our galaxy. These are very weak, can only reach those that are in our galaxy, and not yet a single one. And the other thing is that, of course, there could also be a superposition of signals that could have an astrophysical origin or a cosmological origin, and therefore you can always try to search for a cosmological background. So the different signals, the different methods to search for them are very different in these different working groups. And at UIB, we make major contribution to these two working groups. LIGO and Virgo collaborations are separate collaborations, but they work together. And for the data analysis, the working groups are completely common and mixed, and all the people is together. Now, the signals can be very different. I'll say some of them have short duration, some others have long duration, some are very well known, some completely unknown, some of them are very annoying. Those ones for LISA can even be more exciting. But we are not alone, and we should not, and we are not working alone, because what is very important is to be engaged in multi-messenger astrophysics. There are many sources that will emit not only gravitational waves, but also electromagnetic waves or neutrinos. And for that reason, it's very important to cooperate with basically optical telescopes, gamma or X-radio, and also neutrinos, in which the leaders or the warm leaders are the same, basically almost in Valencia, with Antares, IC3, and so on. And we have only two papers that I have not read. So if you have any questions about neutrinos, ask him. There are many reasons for which we want, I don't enter into details, you want to know more about this, I can tell you. Just to point out that before we started the advanced detector area, there were 75 MOU signed with partners of 19 countries in which they were contributing about 150 instruments able or that could respond in principle to do follow-ups of any interesting kind of signal that we could see in the data. And basically, the agreement is that we will be passing something of the order of one a month, and they can be entertained with what we pass to the electromagnetic counterparts. I'll leak information. Now, Advanced LIGO is not. It's a completely different detector for what was initial LIGO. It's a big difference. Basically, it's going to order, improve the sensitivity one order of magnitude and also improve the sensitivity of frequency. That means that, for example, in the case of neutron star mergers, there's going to have a reach of 100,000 galaxies. And one hopes that the merger can happen every, one merger can happen every 10,000 years per galaxy. Basically, we hope that when LIGO reaches this high sensitivity, we could have a neutron star detection, let's say per month, or of this order of magnitude. These instruments, as you also know here, I'm missing some numbers here, as you can see, some zeros. It takes many years. For example, Advanced LIGO started in 2008 and has been completed last year. And LIGO started in 1990. And now has been the first science run has already taken place. And this weather prediction of several years ago, now it's published in Living Reviews, but it was in the archive for several years, of the sensitivity and the plans of what was planning to do both LIGO and Virgo for the next advanced era. So we said that we will be doing a 3-month run, at the end it has been a 4-month run, and the sensitivity could be anything about this blue. This is frequency, this is sensitivity, and the lower the curve, the better it means. Then we plan, starting September, do a half a year run, and then we hope to reach this sensitivity here. Then a 9-month run, and then finally around 2019, try to reach this line sensitivity. Virgo, something similar, but with a bit different sensitivities, and basically like between 1 and 2 years behind from LIGO. So Virgo plans to join in the second science run. Then, whatever has always been measured like for the sensitivity or whatever was like the gold or the holy candidate was always the binary neutron star mergers. And then we always say which was the range for them. And taking into account the most pessimistic models or the most optimistic ones, you could do some calculations on how many of these mergers you are planning to observe. So in this current, in the last run, we are planning to see zero. In the next of 6 months, I would say zero. When 9 months run, okay, so if the expectation is between 0.04 and 100, maybe this could mean 1, 2, 0. And when we are at design sensitivity, then it gets more serious because between 0.2 and 200, I think that 10 or 20 could be reasonable. But as you see, these are the orders of magnitude for a source in which we know that they exist, and there have already been several of them observed. Not many, but some. For binary black holes don't need to have masses of 1.4 or 1.5 solar masses, they could be more massive. And the more massive you are, the stronger the signal is, and far away you can see. Of course, black holes might not exist depending on the mass. And also, what are the changes? Well, from LIGO to Advanced LIGO, it has increased the laser power. The signal recycling that was already in GEO now has been incorporated to LIGO. We have basically bigger mirrors. Not sure if now they are 40 kilos. Better coatings. Has increased the cavity finesse. And there has been a very big investment in seismic isolation and suspension. So we fuse silica, catalysis bonding, many things. Cantilever springs on the top, 4 levels of. And this, when you do a better seismic isolation, you're putting this wall here down in frequency. To reduce the Brownian motion, this goes further down. And when you increase the laser power, you're reducing the quantum noise from here to there. And this is the hope of factor 10 and a huge improvement here that also favors systems with higher masses. But let's go now to reality. A bus LIGO started operation last September and finished mid-January. It has been a 4 months run. And the great surprise is that from the moment the detectors were on, that the sensitivity they were having was even better than what you saw in what we were expecting for this first run. This means that this is the sensitivity of the last run in 2010. This was the current sensitivity. And this is just a factor 3 better, only 3. But the factor 3 better means a factor 3 better in distance, and means that the volume that no one can observe is 27 times larger than what we were having a few years ago. And this volume eventually will be 1,000 times larger when we reach the factor 10. This is Miquel Oliver, one of my PhD students. That since we have to do also the shifts, I sent him to do a shift for 3 months at LIGO Hanford in the desert, surrounded nuclear champignons. Well, there are many nuclear people here today. And coinciding with the timing which the detector was going to get online, and I was sure that he will remember the experience and he will remember this for the rest of his life, and now I am pretty convinced that he will never forget. But he will never forget because Monday, 14th of September, was the day that I start teaching. We have finished the Spanish relativity meeting on Friday. Alex Benjamin also defended the thesis on Friday. And I have still all the paperwork to do of a certain conference. And as soon as I'm back from class, at noon, something fantastic happened that the Earth vibrated, but this time was measured. And these are the time frequency maps of Hanford and Livingston. The signal was first seen in Livingston and 7 milliseconds later in Hanford. And one could see how the frequency increases from 35 Hz to 150 Hz in 2 tenths of a second. In less than 3 minutes that this happened, there was the online analysis running a software or a code called the Coherent Wave Burst, referee from UIB, recorded the event. And this event is similar to this whoop, but shorter. Exactly. Is this whoop? Final thing. The rest is the noise. That's what you can hear if you convert it into sound. And in less than an hour, you have an Italian guy called Marco Drago, one of the ones that has written this code, working at the Max Planck, that has already looked into this thing and said in the mail, it's not like a hardware injection. We usually like these games, putting injections, blind injections. We have done tests in the past. It took 1 year of work the last time we did a blind injection. We were having a PR written at that time and then we broke it into pieces. It says, as we understand, after some fast investigation, there are no hardware injections. Can someone confirm that is not a hardware injection, plus the system of hardware injection on the software accelerators was like not working. An hour later, Florida already wakes up. Sergei Kimenko, another of the writers of this code, says, okay, this is a very significant, beautiful spiral with a cheer mass. Cheer mass, let me convert it into normal things. So he already knew from a brutal analysis, very brutal, that the guys involved, the sum of the two bodies, will be between 60 and 70 solar masses. And the background with no data was extremely promising. And by the way, we are on engineering run 8. We have not yet started its proper observational period. We are still doing the latest tests. Okay. So you wait the 9 hours corresponding until Hanford can wake up, for difference from Spain. And also, there was a Mare Nostrum proposal to be submitted the day after. We need some data from the student if I can do some calculations. It need some more information to put on the proposal. How many CPUs we need. And it's time to wake up Miquel. But Miquel woke up very early that morning, and the first thing he did was to drive with all the colleagues, those on shift and those not on shift that day, all went to over the Hanford. What the hell were, I don't know how many emails there were after 2 hours, that was huge. And they started basically amazing. They start changing, checking, I don't know if the 500 channels, but I don't know how many channels they were checking. All the injection systems, if they are hackers, non-hackers. So 8 p.m. Spain time, we were on the Skype with him asking, is an injection or what the hell is going on? And he was like, no, it's not an injection. It was forbidden to say that. The collaboration knew it about a week later, when there was an official announcement that this is not an injection, and one has to work against the clock from that moment on. And this is basically what it's observed. This is a simulation from UIB, in which these are university orbits, two black holes that can be millions of years, orbiting around each other, and depending how is the orientation of the spins and so on, this is the main part of the waveform that observe. And now we are getting approaching merger. They will start going faster, the frequency also goes faster, also the amplitude increases. The peak will happen when now that they merge, and now you see the ring down of the signal until this system completely relaxes. You can watch it on YouTube if you want. And another simulation done from our group. Basically, this is, well, for the relativist, this is C4, as far as I've been told, so curvature. You have the two black holes that are separated, and eventually, now you even could guess the waveforms. Now you start seeing things, how the curvature changes. We are getting closer, closer, not yet, and merge. And now they will start the ring down until it gets completely relaxed, and no more signal. And now this is the signal that has been traveling for a long time, coming from a long distance until it has reached us. And these are the boys, and even the one that has been doing the visualization is doing the trabajo de fin de grado with us, not even a master student. So we use whatever we have. We explode the students. But if you want to come with us, please, the crowd is welcome. And this is the signal in time domain, in Hanford and in Livingstone, and then you shift for the 7 milliseconds the signal from Hanford to Livingstone, and then you also invert it, and you see that this is basically the same. You see it with, even with bare eye. You need to filter, you see the signal. You might say, I don't see anything. Well, I do see. I'm more used to. If you are interested, you can download all the data that is freely available. Also, the paper is open, and all the papers and accompanying papers are in the archive. And Valencia group has already downloaded the data, analyzed the data, and I think they have agreed that we have done the analysis properly. And they did it in 1 week?
1 week, yes.
At least we published 1,000 of papers, they just won. Remarkable. So this is the time domain data. And here you don't see a thing, because I don't see it either. You have, in light gray, what is the reconstructed waveform, basically using a mod without templates. That's the thing, but okay, it's there. In dark one, the waveform that you could have extracted while doing image filtering, so which is the filter that has approached the best, and then taking the parameters from this best parameter estimation, you have done a numerical simulation, and check what is the waveform looks like. And as I say, that is basically the only thing you see except from here bit, is that the three things are basically the same. And if you subtract that from the data, you just get the residual that is the usual noise. So I would say, nature is fantastic, has done a nice present to start to celebrate the century of general relativity. It has provided a black hole merger, a textbook one, clear, easy, without precession, but we have messed it up a lot, and exactly as general relativity predicts. Einstein equations, invalid. So what we have seen? So we have seen the black hole measure two black holes of 36 and 29, so much time, you can talk forever. But if you want a 2 hours colloquium, you have no problem. 36 by 29 solar masses, resulting from black hole 62, so some doesn't work out very well. There are three solar masses that have been emitted as radiated energy in a fraction of a second. The peak radiated energy is basically 50 times larger than the whole observer universe. And given the amplitude of the signal, we know that the distance is around 410 megaparsecs, so 1,300 million light years away. DSNR of 24, and at least this implies that we have a 5.07 sigma signal. That's not the only thing we have seen in the data that has been published. There is a second event that we call LIGO-Virgo trigger, not detector, but trigger, because we're just a 2 sigma event. But also, would, if real, it would correspond to also black hole merger of 23 plus 13 solar masses, at 3 times the distance that the previous was. So this is a much weaker one. And since here you have a 2% probability that this happens by a random, you can call a press conference with this. You're doing fine. But that this was the first. So, what are the facts? The facts is that there has been the first direct discovery of gravitational waves. We have seen the waves for the first time. We have seen for the first time black holes. We have gotten the signal directly from these black holes. We have seen the first merger of black holes. It has been the first discovery of stellar mass black holes of masses around 30 that nobody knew if they were existing or not, and how these two merge and form another black hole of around 60. So we also have known that the 30 solar masses do exist and the 61 also exists. And this also has been used to do the first strong test of general relativity. And if you want some other interesting things, is that the peak speed of the black hole just before merger was 0.6, the speed of light. And to do the analysis just of this, we only needed 50 million CPU hours. And that's not too much, we should consume more. So, for this case, this is the anatomy of the signal. By now you are familiar with it. When they are inspiring each other, basically this can be easily described analytically, either by post-Newtonian approach or by effective one-body approach. The ring down also, the perturbation theory, but basically, when they are going before merge or when they are merged, the only way to analyze this, the dynamics are very strong. The only way you can do, either for black holes or by neutron stars, is to use numerical relativity. For that, you can get all the information. And the analysis, either you can use waveforms or not. The optimal one is that you use match filtering, in which, given the data, you need to do like all these inner products or correlate it with the expected template. That's the way that you will get the strongest output out. So basically, the comparisons that now we are doing is like you go with your funny mobile phone and you are in a pub or cafe that is very noisy and there is this song playing and you wonder, what's the song? What's actually what? And then you just put this device, you wait a bit, and the device answer is so-and-so with this probability, and if it's not so, it's this other song with this other probability. So what's going on with this phone? You know, it has a catalog of songs, a large catalog of songs, and they start comparing these very interesting algorithms, the noise with this embedded sound, and tries to compare, and then tells you this is the one that approaches the most. So this is basically the same thing we do. And for that, we need to know what we search for. And we need to know, basically, we have to get help for numerical relativity, for this case and for also for others. And we have to run on big supercomputers, like Mare Nostrum, SuperMOOC, and so on. Now, the point here is just to compute these few milliseconds of a collision of either neutron stars or black hole, for a supernova, this can take several hundreds hours, many weeks or hundreds of processors and so on. So it typically could be 1 week on Mare Nostrum, depending how many processors you can use. And what is important is that, of course, you cannot do this for all the detector, for all the possible combinations, is that you really need accurate modeling of black holes. And this we have been working a lot in UIB for many years, not just in doing numerical relativity, but then in extracting information from numerical relativity and from the analytical models to propose analytical models to do the searches. And basically, from UIB, with other collaborations, we have what we call the one of the approaches to attack this, that is the phenomenological waveforms. And, well, and this just to come with the searches. The searches, we do different ones. The online are basically based for these kind of short things, triggers or something, you know, with the unmodeled ones. If we have been using just the unmodeled searches, we have come up that the signal by just a 4.6 signal. But using the match filtering, we have come out that it's a 5.1. And basically, this is what we do, not in the spin, but just on masses. We have the masses of the two bodies, and you have to produce the template for all possible combinations of these masses and such. And this was the template here that rang the bell, that was the interesting one. And here you have a table, I guess you cannot read it, with the event and the trigger, how this is much more bigger. And regarding this 5.1 sigma, how it came, or a very rough estimation of how this comes, one realizes that basically we can estimate the background doing time shifts between the data of the two detectors, and you have to do time shifts of about 0.1 seconds to be safe. So if we wanted to claim a full detection, so like with the standards of the 5 sigma, we knew that we needed at least 16 days of coincidence data between Livingstone and Hanford to estimate it from the background to claim that this was a 5 sigma. So basically, all the results that have been published are based on basically the first 2 months of data, in which 2 months of data has implied that you just have these 16 days of coincidence data. And then you have here trials factor 3 for the pins needed, and basically this 5.1 sigma comes for the trials factor, the 16 days of confidence, 24 hours, and the number of time shifts that you can do. And this is how basically you can get. And this graph here shows you whatever this was the detection statistics, the signal, the number of events, and the background. This is the background estimation, and this is the other background estimation if you exclude the event. And here we are at 5 sigma. And this second strong one is the other trigger. And the rest of the data is compatible with the background. Now, in the graph before, you saw that the template diagram was at that corner, and then where the density of dots was very little. So even we knew more or less what the parameters are, that's not enough. You have to do good parameter estimation. You can do that with Bayesian analysis. And for that, two models, waveform models, have been used. In spiral merger ring down phenomenological, meaning Mallorca and collaborators, effective one-body approach NR, meaning Alessandro Bonanno and Max Planck. And in the paper's results, there have been the results from UIB, Max Planck, well, Max Planck and collaborators, in which basically for the estimations of distance, like inclination angles, masses, final spins, and so on, how all of that coincide more about the spins. Now, more curiosities. So, funny, at the beginning of September, there was, before the Spanish Relativity meeting, we were meeting in Hungary, we were having the LIGO Virgo meeting there. And before we start in the run, before we have a detection, we already even have voted. We vote from time to time. And we voted again to which journal we will be publishing if we will have a detection. So that was voted in September 9th without having a single detection. Detection, September 14th. We contact PRL December. We fixed the press conference for February 11th, at the beginning of January. We sent the paper to the journal 21st of January. We got the referees for the comments from the referees 1 week later, and then the final version was submitted to PRL at the end of the month. There have been also a kind of a dozen of accompanying papers. The list is not completed because now I'm missing out the electromagnetic one and the neutrino ones in the list. And then I also point here, and basically I think it's of the order of 30 citations of papers from UIB are cited in these papers. So, LIGO, we did it. This is the funny picture. September 14th started the new era of gravitational wave astronomy. We got congratulations from Obama president, president from India as well. And a week later, LIGO India was approved. It was the fastest approval ever. The information, as I said, when we have an interesting candidate is passed for electromagnetic follow-up, except that when you just have two detectors, our pointing is horrible. So this is, this together with this, is the area for possible follow-up. So, well, this has been all the areas that have been follow-up, either by radio, optical, infrared, X-ray, gamma, and so on. And Fermi claims that they have a candidate, but they care that whatever Fermi has found, it could be compatible with anything. I mean, this area is huge. I don't think it has anything to do with our beautiful black holes. Now, we have only analyzed or published half of the data. So what are our expectations? Well, now given that we know the black holes exist, that the black holes exist, of these 30 solar masses, now we can estimate like, how many we think we can see, because now we have seen one, half. So, we know that we have a 90% probability to observe a second event in a one. Maybe there, maybe not, we have a 90%, so well, this is still working. For the run of 6 months, it's longer in time, but also more sensitive, we expect between 5 and 10. And for the run of 9 months, that is also more sensitive, it could be on the order of 30, more, 5, or whatever. Let's see. So what needs to be done? Well, analyze the second half of the data for transients, but also to do other searches. My beloved neutron stars, which, as I said, these are very weak signals. We have to integrate for many months to see something because they are much weaker. Well, I guess you all know what are neutron stars, very compact bodies, the size of Minorca, with a mass of 1.9 times the sun, the mass of the sun, and we could get more information. And at UAB, we have contributed a lot of software to the LAO library. We also have contributed to some core parts of something called Anything at Home that you can start Googling. It's like SETI at Home to search for pulsars. Don't do it on your cell phone, compare sometimes, it gets hot. But the computers here, you have many, but you have a tier 2 center. Download Anything at Home. We already have reached several years ago a petaflop computing barrier. When we are free, we are also analyzing data from Fermi to look for gamma pulsars, not even gravitational waves. And we have been leading the search for unknown pulsars in our galaxy since many in all the science runs that LIGO has performed. And for these boring pulsars, since they slow down, they are losing energy. If you would assume that all the energy they lose goes into gravitational waves, you could start putting like the theoretical upper limits that for sure the amplitude of the wave cannot be higher than that. This is what we call the spin down limits. This is frequency, this is for all the pulses that are in the catalog, how many pulses they are. And for a few of them, we have already surpassed the spin down limit, particularly for Crab and Vela. And for Crab, we know that less than 1% of the energy that radiated could go into gravitational waves. Otherwise, we would have seen the pulsar. But since we have only about 2,000 or 2,500 or 3,000, I don't know, pulses in the catalogs nowadays from our galaxy that are known, but I know that neutron stars could be on the order of 10 to the 8, and a pulsar maybe 10 to the 5, it could be many, many other pulsars close by that are not pointing electromagnetically in our direction. We are searching for them. since people will ask me about the stochastic background of BSEP and so on, I don't know anything about the stochastic background, I just can put you this whole slide in which Ligonville has two different upper limits on the stochastic background, but only you can see something in between a few hertz and the kilohertz. In 2010 or later, we put an upper limit that was better than PBN, and when it reaches like a full sensitivity, basically the upper limits will be here. So that means that maybe you could say something about several models, theoretical models. You could also maybe say something about if there could be like a background of non-binary black holes that have become popular. But if you're asking if we could say something about the inflation models claimed by BSEP2, the answer is no way, because those models are here, are several orders of magnitude below our sensitivity. So no way that I can say anything about these inflation models. Maybe other ones, maybe, but this, zero. For this, I will have to wait third generation detectors or beyond. So means maybe 20 more years. If you put LISA in a space, I guess LISA will be doing something like this. So, I don't know, that depends. What happened? And that's not all. Already in Europe, it has been many years ago that one of the Magnificent Seven is this ancient telescope, a future third generation detection that could be underground, arms of 10 kilometers, using cryogenics and so on. And that would also increase one more order of magnitude from Advanced LIGO. And if Advanced LIGO can start making the first detections, so here you have the expectations for the different systems, and it could be a few, maybe hundreds, I don't know, we don't completely know. When you go to a T, the most pessimistic tells you of thousands, and the most optimistic we're talking about millions of sources. So you can do precision gravitational wave astronomy. Of course, if you are interested in more massive objects, I think I'm very happy that, well, the gravitational wave universe, well, one of the themes selected by ESA as the cosmic vision, the large three mission, that implies that could be launched around 2034. And this year of the century, I think, is a great success for gravity, because it was the launch of this Pathfinder. It's doing great. It has also a very strong Spanish contribution. It's flying, and the test masses has already been detached, and they are starting doing now all the measurements this last week. So we are all waiting for their results. We have now this last month shadow on them, but I think this will also be in green light. And if you are really interested in backgrounds of supermassive black holes, then yes, go. I will not get more into pulsar timing arrays. I think it's far too late. If you like it, this topic, if you want to know more about the detection, you can look into our web pages, page LIGO, dedicated to the event. If you don't understand a thing, or you want the kids to look into other things, you can go into our outreach pages that got the CEPAM Prize some years ago. It's not changed too much since then. There are games, movies, and so on. And otherwise, I invite you to follow on Twitter, but I hate Twitter. You can follow me on Facebook, or you can download movies that we keep uploading them for numerical visualizations on YouTube. So, oh, that was not supposed, okay, but then I thank you all for your patience for coming here, and all my acknowledgements, including Cepan, Renata, Multidark, etc. That are also from here. Thank you.
Thank you very much for this interesting colloquium, and now we have time for some questions.
I guess this is for me?
Yes.
Congratulations, Alicia, for this historical discovery.
So was better, the Spanish version or the English one?
Let me make a comment, which is really a comment, but I would like to know your opinion about it. You see, you mentioned the previous Nobel Prize on the effects in the binary system. I say a previous Nobel Prize because there is no doubt that there will be a Nobel Prize, an ex-Nobel Prize for this historical discovery that I mentioned. You have also mentioned electromagnetic waves. You see, these effects in the binary system, in the history, in the historical perspective of the electromagnetic waves, is like magnetic induction by Faraday. That means the electric effects for a varying magnetic field, or the displacement current by Maxwell. What are the magnetic fields induced by a varying electric field? Your discovery is Hertz, the direct detection of electromagnetic waves, Hertz. But there is still a third step in the history of electromagnetic waves, the photon. Then I think it's time to start about perhaps looking at the history of electromagnetic waves, how quantum effects of the gravitational fields could be seen. You see, normally the attitude is that impossible. Okay?
Not necessarily.
But I think it's time to start with this impetus, with this momentum given by your discovery. To start thinking on quantum effects of the gravitational field itself. Quantum effects in the motion of particles, which are, you see, moving in an external gravitational field. This is something that has already been observed in neutron interferometry, which is fantastic. Okay? Quantum effects in the motion of particles, which are move under the action of an external gravitational field. But this is not the point. The point is quantum effects of the field itself. The gravitational.
I mean, you can always
feel. And you said that, you see, perhaps there is a possibility, and I would like to see what is your opinion about that.
Well, basically, in the case of binary systems, in which these wavefronts are nicely well modeled, you have models coming from general relativity, from other Kennedy's theories of gravity. And these are also people looking into that. Because if you use other alternative theories of gravity, and you could use other theories not very far away from GR, or putting some extra ingredients, then just by adding one or two parameters more in the face of the model, you could start getting information. So you could do it very hard, but then you will get no information at all, or you can start with theories as close as possible to general relativity. I mean, and of course, you can do more things when you have more events. With one, you could just do the consistency check of what you expect from the spiral itself, from merger itself, and from that itself. But when you have more, I think there is the group in Nitrev with Chris van den Berg that are also doing, or they are ready, to do a lot of Bayesian analysis considering other models to see which you have the odds that you prefer another theory for the wavefront that you are observing.
I have a curiosity. I would like to know how you manage this alert system together with the injection system. So you are connected to all these gamma ray observatories, neutrino telescopes, and what happens when the signal is a hardware injection?
We do many things. So I'm not sure of any other experiment in which does really hardware injections like we do. So basically what you do is that we have some model waveforms coded up, and then with certain software, you push the mirror directly to mimic the displacement that will produce the gravitational waves. But of course, with that, you are leaving a trace in the channels that we are always forbidden to look, but this time with search, that we could say like it's clean. Because if you have an activation system on, and usually these are random. And when we do injections, we have the open injections that we know to test our pipelines, our model, or even test if, I mean, with doing injection, we have found out that maybe we are having a phase of 180 degrees between Livingston and Hanford that was not considered. And then you're like, oh, okay, you solved many problems, apart of who is the pipeline that is the winner to detect things. So you is by activating things. And usually, almost always, we have the ones with the parameters known and some others of unknown parameters. And we do injections for all the types of signals. Except that it was not working during the engineering line, it was disconnected. So that's one thing we do. Now what was the second part of the question?
That you are connected to all those different experiments looking for gamma rays.
Okay.
So are they alerting?
There are like three ways we work together. So either, for example, electromagnetic people pass us information. For example, they pass us all the GRBs, Fermi and Swift pass all the GRBs. And if they pass you the GRB, you know in which position in the sky the source is, and at what time has happened. And with that you can do much, much deeper searches. And for example, what we did 2007 was, for example, there was a very strong, short, hard gamma ray burst, and you think that what the claim is that a progenitor could be a binary system in which one of the bodies is a neutron star. And funny, in this case, the directional was overlapping with one arm of Andromeda. Andromeda is our closest galaxy, and I could see galaxies. So there were already appearing papers claiming, okay, you have a GRB there in Andromeda, because this was very strong. And we said, like, if this, the progenitor, is a binary system, it's not there, because we don't see the gravitational wave signal. If it's another thing, GR flare or whatever, okay, but not if the progenitor is a binary system. And we search for all the GRBs that have passed to us, and we have never seen. So we can only claim that whatever has happened is out of our reach, because we have not seen the signal for GRBs. Another thing we do is that, what I saw now, is that we analyze the data very fast. You better have 3 detectors, not just 2. And we give them pointing locations to the other ones, so that they can try to search if there are some kind of afterglows. Or what we do with wide field telescopes or with neutrinos, don't have to worry, don't have to come hysteric. We can collect the data together, and then we can analyze it together afterwards to see if we see anything together. Coincidences. Okay? So basically, there are these three types of doing things.
More questions?
I'm not a physicist, so I will be less technical. I was wondering, I heard you say, and I've read it before, that we could detect maybe the Big Bang.
How was the Big Bang?
Okay. I was wondering, do you have any idea how far we are from that? What we would need in equipment or time?
I think we are... Well, if you would have asked me at the meetings when we will see a thing, I would have said 2017, 2018, and we got it now. If you ask me now, you go for a normal model of inflation, I think we have to wait Einstein telescope for 20 years.
So from space, basically?
No, from ground 20 years, and from a space, is 20 years until you see anything, but I'm not sure if we will see anything with LISA. There could be other alternative projects to send to space that could be tuned, maybe to DIC, but I don't know which is the current model.
Any other question?
So for the Einstein telescope, I mean, you plan to build only one, or you still need to have more than one for
the Einstein telescope? this has this triangular shape in order not to build a square, but a triangle, and then the triangle is like the original idea of LISA, in which you have one detector, two detectors, and three detectors. So basically, if you want, just by doing 30 kilometers, you have three detectors in the same place. Of course, you are sharing arms, and you are sharing then some noise sources, but you can do many things. So, I always say, like in the Monedos, the villages are very spread. There's a lot of space there. Yes, because you already have three. Except that if instead of 90 degrees you have 60 degrees, then there is a square root of 3 divided by 2 that you're losing on sensitivity or whatever.
So, final question?
You have two, one in Europe and one in the States.
Any further question?
I think people are very tired after a long
time. They want to have lunch. Okay, thank you very much, Alicia.